back to the Late Late Bar, as it is now. Lots of people joining us this evening. We have Aidan Gillen joining us this evening. Welcome, Aidan. It's good to see you. Pat Bergen, Patrick Bergen joining us as well. Glenn Hansard's in there. Moya Brennan's there. Philomena Begley's over here. Sean O'Shea's over there. People coming and going. It's that kind of evening. All here to celebrate the one and only Mr. Shane McGowan. He is. He's here. He's a punk, a poet, an Irishman, an emigrant, an outsider. As I said earlier, the world is truly a better place for having Shane in it. So shall we get this party started, ladies and gentlemen? Would you please welcome, with an amazing band, Mr. Shane McGowan!
Jimmy Player, my getting the power I was born. He played it from the nighttime, and please learn him more. He sang a song of sales, and then I had the heart. They all are very happy in the morning. But Jimmy didn't like his voice, and his word of it. We have a lot of strong and great powers. So to see a degree without the people that I mean, we took the road for God knows in the morning. We walked to the station in the rain. Yeah, we chased the music, put him on the train. Now we sang every song, the story is long gone. Though we hear that we'd be seeing him again. To say it was the only way. But in the air we see us and going far away. To think of a return when we can. To grace and live the pleasure and to study back in man. To purchase and study back in man. We took the cheers and drank the beers and called back on the door. And ended up a barman in the morning. Jimmy didn't like his place in this world of ours. But the other woman, no one went to the answer, many of hers. Such a thing that could even have the paper that I don't leave. He took the road, but then not in the morning. We lost him to the station in the rain. Yeah, we kissed him as we put him on the train. Now we sang him a song, a tired song gone. Though we knew that we'd be seeing him again. When Jimmy came back home, he was surprised that they were gone. He asked me how the did out of the train they were on. Some people they were scared to go up with Jimmy drank a tea show. Took the road for heaven in the morning. We walked to the station in the rain. Yeah, we kissed him as we put him in the train. And we sang him a song. But the time's long gone. Though we knew that we could see him again. Far away! To say, what's the only way? To play the middle where she has to go far away. Far away! To think of a return with a gun. To grace the boys are the same.
More songs and plenty of conversation to be had with Shane. And as he makes his way over here, we're going to have a look at a couple of messages from friends around the world sending their love.
I'm here to tip my hat to my friend Shane McGowan, whose voice revealed something deep and beautiful about the Irish soul.
You took aspects of Irish culture and Irish music, kicked it up the arse with a great sense of pride and joy and rebelliousness, and sent it out into the world. And it was feckin' great. It stopped us all moping into our pints or into our Bailey's Irish cream and took pride in ourselves.
The boys of the NYPD choir still singing, go away, bye. And the bells are ringing out for Christmas Day.
Tubbs, take good care of our show. We love him.
I moved to London in my early 20s and it was often quite a lonely time to begin with. And where Shane's writing and performing spoke to the punk in me as a teenager, he was now speaking to me as a young Irishman alone in London trying to find his way.
He has vast empathy for other human beings, their excesses, their joys, their failings and struggles. He has a poet's eye for seeing things in everyday life that most of us don't see.
He has that really special gift of making it feel like he's speaking to and for your soul alone. And it's one of the many reasons why he is a truly great artist and an amazing man.
Great that you're on the Late Late Show. I'm kind of surprised that you're not on the Late 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 Show. But lots of love to you, Shane.
Punk, poet, Irishman, outsider, rock on, Shane.
Have a great night, buddy. Proud of you.
He said you're a punk and a poet and an Irishman. He calls you a punk, a poet and an Irishman.
A punk, a poet and an Irishman.
Yeah. How do you feel about that? Take it down, ladies and
gentlemen. Pretty contradictory, man.
Well, there you are. How are you doing, Shane?
I'm not all right, as well as for a punk, a poet and an Irishman.
And an Irishman. Welcome to the Late Late Show. It's good to see you.
I've been in here before.
I know, but welcome back.
Before you.
That's true. Welcome back. Well, that's me in my place before you've even started, but it's good to see you. Talk to us, if you would, because we've been talking about you today and about the Irish musical influence on your life down through the years, from the Chieftains to Sean O'Rear. Who was it that you were listening to that you loved musically?
Well, all my family, like all the stuff on the radio, Radio Aaron and Radio Nightingale Sister. The stuff on Sean O'Shea over there.
Yeah.
And the rest of the O'Riordan band, like, including the man himself, yeah.
And when you were in Tipperary as a boy,
yeah.
What sort of house was it in terms of music, poetry, art?
Lots of music, lots of Mountain Dew.
Yeah.
Lots of rosary saying before all that, yeah. My auntie used to lead the rosary, and she really did it really passionately, yeah?
Yeah.
And added lots of novenas for her horses that she bet her to win. And we used to do pray when we were doing the Irish sweepstakes, so we were always winning.
And what sort of, did
it work?
Did it work? Thank you. Nice question.
Yeah.
Nice question.
No, it did.
What about your mum and dad, your mother and father? What were they like for you?
My mother was a great singer. She knew the entire Delia Murphy and Maggie Barry repertoire and lots of Irish songs, like classic Irish songs.
Yeah. And your dad?
He used to sing Foggy Dew, remember?
The Foggy yeah. Dew, yeah. And the Foggy, not the Foggy Dew, I always
yeah,
sing Foggy,
yeah.
I should introduce Siobhan, by the way. This is Shane's sister, Siobhan McGowan, who joins us tonight. Welcome. Because I've been hearing that Shane was extremely bright, very interested in the world, well-read
so
kid.
So is she.
Yeah, and that's why I'm asking, did he teach you or did you teach him?
No, I think we're just born that way.
Yeah.
Like just kind of very interested, very curious.
She tried to kill me most of the time.
Did I?
Yes.
Do you want to have this out? I mean, this is great. I mean,
it was just childhood mucking about. You know.
Yeah. Do you remember the murder attempt?
No, I don't. But he brings it up, you know, every Christmas or whatever. But
Christmas, you know.
That proves you really are an Irishman.
Exactly.
Works from a dry stone wall, yeah. Which you were capable of aiming really well, yeah. You know.
I've got a really good aim.
You've got a great shot. Did you ever?
I learned very early to drop.
So you've got a good shot.
I shaved the top of my head.
Yeah.
He was a good ducker.
And he was a good ducker. Yeah.
Glenn Hansard, talk to me about Shane McGowan. As when you were a younger man, listening to him, his lyrics, his music, how important he was to you. Tell us a bit about that.
Well, growing up in Ballymun, there was like, if someone would be passing around the tape would have the Dubliners on one side. The Dubliners, the Pogues, AC/DC, Bob Marley, mostly Bob Marley, the Dubliners and the Pogues. And for me, like, the bardic tradition in Ireland, I mean, certainly in or around my lifetime, Shane mentioned Maggie Barry, but you had Joe Heaney and, you know, Luke Kelly, of course, and Liam Clancy and Jesus, Damien Dempsey and Sinead and, you know, Christy, of course. But what made Shane's music, and it feels strange saying it while you're here, but what made Shane's music and the Pogues' music different for me was that it was speaking to the broad diaspora. And the word diaspora means the scattered tribe. And so there was something about, like, I remember seeing the Pogues in London in the late 80s in the Town and Country Club. And there was an energy in the room that was really terrifying and frightening. Like, I didn't understand. Like, I was actually freaked out because it was mental energy. You know, some of the lads are here. And what I realized was that, because I had cousins in Birmingham and they used to sing Irish songs with much more gusto than I ever, or my parents ever sang them. And it had something to do with being away from Ireland and not being quite English, not being quite Irish. And so kind of leaning into the identity, if you like.
Yeah.
And so when the Pogues came along, there was just this shock of like passion and devotion.
What attracted you to that type of music then, ultimately? Was it history? Was it the musicality of it? What was it?
It was the energy, the melody, the violence, the anger, I just felt, but it just hit me in the heart and the gut and the soul. Yeah.
I want to bring in Moya Brennan, if I may. You're welcome. But ladies and gentlemen, Moya Brennan, wonderful. You go back some time with Shane.
We do, yeah. Well, I mean, I like Glenn talking about going to see early Pogues. I remember seeing the Pogues in the Francis Xavier Hall, and I'll never forget it. It was just, as Glenn was saying, the energy was amazing. But I think we used to kind of meet up down in the clubs more so. That's when I got to know you.
You and your brothers were...
That's right. We used to frequent down there.
A bunch of nutters, yeah.
But then when we were put together we were asked to do a song together, and I was thrilled. It was for a movie called The Circle of Friends.
Yeah.
Maeve Binchy movie. I wrote the book. And I was very excited to work with Shane. And I remember we were working with Trevor Horn.
I was excited to work with her.
Well, thank you. But we decided to re-record it again, though.
Yes.
One of the memories I have is like picking you up and eventually getting you into the car. It was late at night. Yeah. And John Reynolds and my husband Tim was there. And the next morning, I mean, I stayed sober because I had to drive him in again. But it was at 7 o'clock in the morning, everybody going to work, 7:30. I was bringing Shane back, and it was kind of a bit surreal, really, just the two of us in the car with everybody going to work. And
you're going the other way. You're stopping a bunch of nutters at that point.
Yeah.
But that beautiful song you mentioned, would you be up to give us a few bars of that? Would that be something you'd be interested in? Would you like to hear a few bars?
Lying in my lonely bed, thought about you as the moon, listening to the sad songs down below, thought about you as the tune, wished that I could let you know. I think about you as the sun, so you're everywhere I go. Darling, I know you're the one.
Let me introduce you to Shane's wife, Victoria Mary Clark. Victoria Mary, you're very welcome. Let me ask you about what question you always want to know, isn't it, when somebody, how did you meet Shane McGowan? Was it an epic encounter?
Do you remember it?
Yeah.
You do.
Why don't you tell her, Shane? I'm on track.
Well, she was being dated by Spider, a Western player.
Yes, that is true.
And he was always leaving her alone at gigs and falling asleep or puking up or something. Yeah? And I'd kind of rescue her from her distress and take advantage of the situation if I could. Because she was a bloody great piece of ass, yeah?
Ladies and gentlemen, Gillan joining us now. It's great to see you tonight. You're here as a friend and a fan, is that fair to say? Or
he sleeps in our bathtub.
He sleeps in their bathtub?
Occasionally, yeah.
Okay, well, rents are a problem. And, tell us about your friendship and relationship with Shane McGowan.
As a youngster, you know, I moved over to London when I was 18 to try and make it as an actor, and, you know, the side of life that I was, you know, attracted to, or that I really wanted to observe, was the same stuff, that the same scene that the Pogues and Shane were mining, you know, the nighttime. I love the night, I love the dark streets of Camden and King's Cross and Soho, you know. I just would be there for nights and months and years and end watching stuff, because it takes years for things to happen. And I was flattered that Shane asked us to present his Ivor Novello Award a few years ago. I don't know if people, how many people know that Shane did win an Ivor Novello Award?
Well, like, fully deserved.
Which was a great night. It's not every night you see Billy Ocean, Lionel Richie, and Shane McGowan on the same bill. But you know, this is a songwriting award. It's for some songwriting and composing. And at this stage of the day, I mean, or at this stage of the game, you know, we all know that Shane is a brilliant frontman, has been with the Pogues and the Popes, a great singer, wears great clothes, has had many great haircuts. But you know what? what we all know that Shane is going to be remembered for these songs, you know, which it's not many songwriters can write a song that sounds like it's been around forever. That the first time you hear on the radio, you went, oh yeah, oh that song. You know, that instant familiarity, there's a few, you know what I mean? A few people can do it. Maybe Bob Dylan can do it, or Nick Cave can do it, or Leonard Cohen can do it, and he can do it. Sure. And I wanted to, you know, be there to try and get that across to the audience that day. And that is what we're here for, I guess, tonight, is celebrating that body of work, which goes down, I think, you know, in the same pantheon as all the great Irish arts and literature, which on the world stage is among the best Irish, it is among the best art and literature in the world.
Patrick Bergen, I'd like to welcome Patrick. Does your relationship go back long with Shane?
Yeah, a fair bit. Similar territory to Aidan's just been talking about. I met Shane.
We've known each other for years.
For years and years, yeah. But we went mainly around Camden Town.
Okay.
There was various places in Camden Town we'd hang out.
Is this the restaurant with the kebab?
There was lots of places in Camden Town, bands playing. Madness used to play there, Clash used to be around, and Pogues, of course. And particularly on a Thursday night, for some reason, we'd all get together. There was a kebab restaurant, the Marathon it was called, opposite the Roundhouse. Euphemistically sometimes called a macgowan, I don't know why. But if you bought a kebab, you could drink there all night. And that was your entry fee. You bought the kebab, you could sit. And it was a bit like this. It was really nice. There was a room, and there were tables all around the room, and each table would, you'd go to each table, and each person would sing a song.
He was always singing.
Say again?
Always singing.
Listen, I'm gonna stop the chat for a second and ask you to do something for us. If you did sing a song, then would you do one for us now? Would that be possible?
God,
would you like to hear a song, favorite from Patrick?
Well, tell me what.
If you have one.
All this talk about London and that. Shane's a great poet, sure. And I'd like to, I might forget a few of the lines, but the All Main Drag is a song that's about London. So Aidan was talking about there. So I'll recite a couple, and maybe the lads will join in and take the second couple of verses off me.
Sounds good.
When I first came to London, I was just 16, with a fiver in my pocket and a head full of dreams. I went down to the Dilly to check out the scene. That's how I ended up on the old main drag. There was he-males and she-males all strutting their style. The old man with the money would give you a smile. Down the dark alley, you could earn another five with a swift twist of the wrist down the old main drag. Go for it, John. Go on.
One evening as I was lying down to Leicester Square, I was picked up by the coppers and kicked in the balls. Between the metal doors as a fine street, I was greener than a ball. And they were wearing my gloves for the old main drag. And now I am lying here, I've had too much booze. I've been spread on and shat on and raped and abused. And I'm lying, I'm dying, and I wish I could beg for some money to take me from
the old main drag.
Well said. Well done, man. All right, we'll be talking more about that immigrant experience a little later on when we're talking to Governor Martin O'Malley, who's going to join us all the way from the United States of America. Welcome, Governor. It's nice to see you. And thanks for being here tonight. Now, and another Irish legend, Sean O'Shea, joining us. Sean, it's great to see you here. Thanks for being here tonight. We have a lot more to do and a lot more coming up on the show with Shane McGowan and friends, but first, have a little look at this.
Make it a new year to remember with a jingle jackpot of €30,000 to spend however you please. And with that €30,000, you could hit the January sales and make over your house, fly to New York and beyond, pack the kids up and go on your dream family holiday, pay off some bills, or simply just treat yourself. How you spend all that cash is entirely up to you. For your chance to win that tempting €30,000 cash prize, answer this. Complete the title of this hit song performed by the Pogues. Is it Fairy Tale of Nepal, New York, or Norway? If you know the answer, call 1517 71 71 81 or text the word late followed by your answer and name to 57117. Calls from the Air Network will cost €2.03. Calls from other networks may be higher. More details on rte.ie. You must be over 18 to enter. Lines will close at 11:25 on January 3rd. I'll be calling someone live during that show when you'll also have another chance to enter. And you must be there to take the call, otherwise you don't get the €30,000 cash prize.
And good luck with all of that, of course. Would you like to hear another tune from Shane McGowan, ladies and gentlemen? This is White City.
Your chair is shining white, once to blame it in the night. Where now is just a rubble in the hall. Here the patties and the frogs, here the gavel and the dogs. Here the gavel and the dogs that run the door. Oh, the torn up ticket stubs from 100,000 mugs. Washed away like dead dreams in the rain. And the car park's going up and they're pulling down the house. And it's just another bloody rain day. Sweet sunny are my dreams, a staying skin and skin. Like Atlantis, you just disappeared from here. And the hair upon your wire has been turned on your fire. Like the black dog that once raced out from trap two. We'll be right back.
Lots more to come. Join us after the break. Music keeps going throughout the breaks and into the night. Here, meanwhile, to perform a beautiful rendition of Rainy Night in Soho, would you welcome, please, Glenn Hansard and Lisa O'Neill, ladies and gentlemen.
The days, and I cried for all your trouble, smiled at your funny little way.
We watched our friends grow up together.
Oh,
We're joined by more guests around us today. I think we're going to chat a little bit about the London years and the London experience, Shane. I mean, when you were kind of into your late teens and early 20s.
It was great. It was great. London was great. It was a great scene, you know. We'd ran all the bars, all the dance halls, all the loads of punks like Johnny Lydon or Johnny Rotten and his brother Jimmy Lydon, who I used to sing rebel songs with, like.
Let me bring in Pat McCabe for a minute, if I can. When you read Shane's lyrics, what do you think, like, as a novelist, as a writer, about what Shane has produced down through the years?
It's almost like there was an alternate history of the rosary in every Irish rural household. You know, the first sorrowful mystery would be Delia Murphy singing The Three Lovely Lassies from Banyan. The second sorrowful mystery would be Burl Ives in Rocket into Space. The third sorrowful mystery would be This Is the Water program, brought to you by your weekly reminders of the grace and beauty that lie in a heritage writer's song. And the next one would be something else that's entirely unrelated that you might find, say, in the pages of Ireland's Own magazine.
Yes.
Curious juxtaposition like Flash Gordon beside the Sacred Heart Messenger, alongside maybe the Bold Fenian Men. And while you kind of think, well, that's kind of odd and perhaps not really quite, it's actually really, really interesting when it finds its form in art, which the Pogues and Shane McGowan did. And I remember kind of being quite envious of it because I didn't really ever write about England, but I remember being in a bar in Harlesden and hearing A Pair of Brown Eyes and hearing Ray and Philomena. I said, at last somebody is telling the truth.
Ray and Philomena.
Yeah, but in the sense that this is the Irish experience, yeah, without it being carefully edited to suit respectability.
I see.
It was the same kick I got out of reading Borstal Boy, yeah, or The Ginger Man. You know, it was often said about Behan that he was the first to take the whine out of Irish literature. Yeah. And perhaps you could say something like that about Shane McGowan.
Yes, yes, I think that's a fair comment. And the Philomena in question, of course, is the great Philomena Begley, ladies and gentlemen, who's joined us tonight. Welcome. And that London Irish experience that we're talking about, I mean, that would chime with you as an entertainer, singer.
I would probably have been went to maybe 50 years ago, when I sang first over in the Galty Moor.
Yes.
And but there was loads of ballrooms all in around London, the Hibernian and Kilburn and Buffalo. And I'm looking at you, but I should be looking at you because you know more about all these ballrooms.
The Buffalo and Camden.
But they were absolutely fantastic, and had loads of, like, there was a lot of Irish people over.
Sure.
In England at that time, the places were always packed, you know. But it was unreal, but all over, you know, even in Birmingham, Manchester, and all over.
You went to see Philomena and Ray.
It was a big Irish festival, yeah. Country and Irish, kiting, sure, set dancers, and all of them used to get really pissed, you know. Everybody used to get really pissed, you know. And I used to end up in places I didn't know where the fuck I was, you know.
Which is the perfect introduction to A Pair of Brown Eyes. Lads, do you want to give us a little tune there? Right there. Because it makes sense.
One summer evening from town, I sat there nearly lifeless. An old man in the corner sat where the water lilies grow. And on the jukebox, Johnny sang the code of thing of love. That is how you did, and what's your name, and how'd you bloody know? In blood and deck, near the screaming sky, I lay down on the ground, and the arms and legs of our men were scattered. Was a pair of brown eyes that was looking at me. And when we got back, labeled parts 1 to 3, there was no pair of brown eyes waiting for me.
I think anyone with a passing interest in American politics would probably be looking at this gathering going, is that Governor Martin O'Malley, who was a former presidential candidate, sitting there among the crowd here tonight? And you're very welcome, and thanks for being with us.
It's a great honour.
You made your way across the Atlantic Ocean to be here tonight, and I'm absolutely...
Where we got a plane?
Well, I didn't specify how you made your way over, but you did. And to be here tonight, why, in a word, why?
Well, because I have for so long admired this man, his passion, his range, and I'm not talking about the amount of notes he sings.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the fact that as an Irish-American kid growing up in the, you know, 70s and 80s in the United States, sure. You know, our kind of portal to an awareness of things Irish through music was mostly the Clancy Brothers and Tommy Makem.
Yeah.
And it was great, Ryan, but it was always our parents' music. But when this guy came along, with the passion and the fierceness, I mean, it really changed it. And yeah. It wasn't just a young guy singing the old songs, you know? It was him making the old songs new again. Mm. So I had gone out to see him many times at like the 9:30 Club and also the Guinness Flop in New York. He's just done so much for Irish music and Irish music throughout the whole diaspora.
Yeah.
I mean, I know a lot of the conversation has been about the Irish in the UK, but, you know, songs like Body of an American and other sorts of songs, Thousands Are Sailing, I mean, that was a real connection for us.
Yes.
That made this music passionate and it made it ours. You know, I went to the 9:30 Club and I remember walking in there, we were late, and there was this crowd of young Irish American kids, mm-hmm. all jumping up and down like the waves of the sea, too. Roddy McCorley. I'm like, oh my God, it's all new again.
Yeah.
And with that, you know, our music kind of took a different direction. We added drums and electric guitar.
Your O'Malley's March is your band, is that right?
O'Malley's March is my band.
Yeah. And did you ever get to play support for Shane then?
Yeah, we did a couple times at the 9:30 Club.
Yes.
And then talking to him backstage, I said, well, you should come to Baltimore. And Shane said, if I come to Baltimore, will you give me the key to the city? I said, if you come to Baltimore, I will give you the key to the city. So about like a year and a half later, I get a call.
Shane McGowan. Anything.
What's that?
It doesn't unlock anything, he said.
Well, as you know, it's a tough place to unlock. I mean,
So everyone just remains locked.
So Shane came to Baltimore, and we opened up for him there too, and it was a magical night, and it was awesome. And he's just been a hero of mine musically, and the poetry and the integrity really of the music.
That song, Body of an American.
Body of an American.
Big song.
Huge song. I once had the opportunity to actually play that at the White House.
You did?
Yeah. President Obama invited my band to play in 2012. We only got to do like four or five songs, but...
You taught that Irish history lesson in the White House through Shane McGowan. I like that story. That's pretty neat, to say the least. Sean O'Shea, you're welcome tonight. It's lovely to see you.
I'm very happy to be here.
Thanks for being here.
Very happy to be here. I consider it a privilege to be here in that man's company.
Well, it's our privilege to have you.
He's been a huge hero. We got a lot of women going, you know what I mean? he's a really good looking guy when he had black hair. He's got a great voice, and he used to sing half in Irish and half in English.
Sean, your years as a Casanova obviously are great interest.
They seem to have slipped me by.
No one told you along the way.
No.
But you know, we've been hearing about, from everyone nearly tonight, about how Shane took Irish music and, you know, put another link in that chain.
I think when I was very, very young, probably nobody here tonight can remember as far back as I can, but in the very early 40s, I remember hundreds leaving West Cork to go to get work in England. And then it'll be very quick, later on when I was singing in places like the White Hart and Fulham Broadway, I met those people.
Yeah.
And they played Irish music, but they had added a dimension, like there's the Clare style Donegal, the Irish in England added their own dimension.
Sure.
I think once the Irish started playing, for instance, they made the piano accordion respectable, I think. Mm. Piano accordion is kind of taboo until then. But, you know, Shane has been a hero of mine, and there's one thing that sets him apart, that if anybody writes a song that will be performed as long as there's Irish people or Americans on this planet, that's a unique achievement. And that's what Fairy Tale of New York has done.
Well, that's lovely to say that. But before I ask you to sing, I'm going to ask you to sing, Vince, I want to talk to Vince Power briefly about the Mean Fiddler venue, which was a sort of musical mecca, if that's not too much to say, but for Irish people in London. Did Shane McGowan change the face of the Irish music scene, or the music scene, I should say, in London?
I think he did. He changed the face of the Mean Fiddler in 1983. I opened in 82, and I opened as my own sort of taste of country music. Shane came along in 83, and it was his first gig at the Mean Fiddler, which was, I think we paid him £25, and all the beer they could drink.
We did drink all night, after.
That changed that night. The DJ I had resigned. He said, "This is not music." And everybody cheered, and he left and never saw him again. And that was the change of the Mean Fiddler. After that, we had people like everybody, Los Lobos, the Pixies, everybody played there. And Shane was the first person that changed that, because we put Shane on, and you know, we weren't doing well with country music, which we had a whole year of country music.
Yeah.
And that was it, really. So Shane was, and I think Shane has done every venue I've ever had. Every festival, he's on Boston, Chicago, San Francisco, New York.
Yeah.
Shane has done everything for me. I could never thank Shane as much as I'd want to. I could never.
Well, I think it's appropriate to get to invite Sean to sing for us tonight, if you wouldn't mind. I mean, given what Martin was talking about, that lovely song.
Can I just say one thing? When I was learning I'll sing the introductory verse to Body of American, you know, and I think it stands on its own, those eight lines or so, as a wonderful poem.
Yes.
As a requiem for a Paddy.
Yeah.
You know?
Well said.
Yeah.
Okay. So, in your own time.
Have a go.
Yeah, I'd love to hear you.
The Cadillac stood in the house, and the Yanks, they were within. And the Tinker boys, they hissed advice, or brought her with a pin. And we turned and scowled and had a shout at the room where the dead men lay. So Big Jim Dwyer boy brought the choir to his people near Galway Bay.
And 15 minutes later, we had our first taste of whiskey. There was uncles giving lectures on ancient Irish history. The men all started telling jokes, and the women, they got frisky. But at 5 o'clock in the evening, every bastard there was missed. Fairly well gone away, there's nothing left to say. Farewell to New York City boys, the Boston MPA. He took them out with a weller clown, they often heard them say, "I'm a free born man of the USA. I'm a free born man of the USA. I'm a free born man of the USA."
Lovely, lovely, lovely. Let me ask you, Siobhan, about, I was talking to you about your childhood growing up and Ireland, and why does the Wild Mountain Thyme resonate in your family, or for Shane?
I don't know that.
Wild Mountain Thyme.
Well, the Clarences were really big.
So
this was one of, this is the song that would have been.
Well, with my parents and. And me and The Dubliners were another one.
The Dubliners, yeah, the crazy.
It's a gorgeous song, and
it resonated, and it's just so beautiful and that kind of thing. But
the thing about this song, I mean, Glenn, you were talking about the diaspora before.
Yeah.
I mean, the real killer line in this song is that we'll all go together.
Yeah.
Well said.
Yeah. I mean, that's the the beauty of the song. It's like the solidarity.
It's a Jacoboy song, yeah. You take the higher, I'll take the lower, which is also a Jacoboy.
Well, that's all also American Revolution.
Let's go for it. Let's hear some of them. It's a beautiful song.
That was lovely. Thank you. By the way, round of applause for our wonderful performers here, friends, all well-known faces, all good eggs. Thanks, guys. It's been great. It's been great. All right, after the break, ladies and gentlemen, the one you've all been...
Say their names, isn't it?
Yes. Say their names?
Yes.
One after another.
Oh, yes.
I'll do it during the break, Shane. After the break, the one you've all been waiting for, it's Fairy Tale of New York. Stay with us. Before we head towards the end of our program tonight, I want to introduce Jem Finer of the Pogues and formerly co-writer of Fairy Tale of New York. And because the song is so iconic and so big, and because we're about to hear it, could you just give us an indication of from what part of the soul did this come from, the song, between the pair of you?
Well, it's a long, complicated process, really. Right. And a top secret one, too.
Well, give us the abridged version.
Well, there was a sort of challenge to us to write a Christmas song.
Okay.
In fact, actually, to start with, it was suggested we did a cover of a Christmas song.
Yes.
And then there was a challenge to write a Christmas song.
And who laid down that gauntlet?
Elvis Costello.
Yeah. Uncle Brian.
I think it was a bet, and I don't think
it was
a bet.
It was a bet. Didn't involve money because he's so tight.
Yeah. Oh yeah, well, I was always wondering where the prize was. Yeah. We obviously won
it, as they call it.
Yeah, we won
so
it,
the
yeah.
bet was the gauntlet stopped.
We won
yeah.
it. Yeah.
You won
yeah.
it, yeah.
yeah. So so we started thinking about writing a song, a Christmas song. And I wrote a Christmas song, and it had the tune was pretty good, and bits of it are in Fairy Tale of New York. And I played it to Marcia, my wife, and she said, you know, like, lyrically, that is, you know, one of the worst sort of things I've ever sort of heard. It's complete crap. It's nothing. You know, it's not a Pogue song. So I said, well, OK, well, you know, make a suggestion. And she said, well, you know, just look around, you know, outside. And sort of she started telling me a story about the sort of roughly based on people down the street, you know. Sort of on hard times, and the guy sort of took all the Christmas money well, it wasn't all the Christmas money, there's very little, and blew it all, you know, in the pub and gambling. And they had a huge sort of falling out. And then, but then somehow there was a kind of bit of, there was some redemption, you know. And so I wrote another song that was musically pretty boring, but it had, and badly written, but it had that storyline in it. And so, you know, Shane took both of those and rewrote the story, transposed it to New York, rewrote it in the brilliant, you know, poetry that it's written in, and put more music with it. And then it took about 3 years for us to get it to actually work musically, you know, sort of, so it's a process of rewriting, editing it, and actually the band becoming competent enough to be able to play it as well.
How do you feel about the song, Shane, looking back?
At the time, I thought we'd really done something good, you know.
Yeah.
Something without selling out or whatever, you know, like.
Yeah, it wasn't
jingle slaved, bells sort of fucking thing.
Yeah, I mean, that was the idea.
It wasn't like, I believe in Father Christmas or fucking. Or John and Louie, I wish I could be home for Christmas, or any of that shit.
It was not.
That's the best review of my man's music by a man that I've ever heard. Jay Fanning, do you remember hearing that song for the first time?
I do remember hearing that song for the first time. I was doing 2FM radio either early evening or kind of very late at night. And for some reason, because we lived only about 3/4 of a mile from where we are right now, everybody used to come back to my place all the time. Like, Spider was back a few times when in the band, and we'd stay up half the night. Anyway, it doesn't matter. It did have the Ennio Morricone bit at the beginning, Once Upon a Time in America, and it did have the Fake Retrench bit at the end. Yeah. So all I was hearing was the real single that we know, which is a pity. I'd love to have heard it as a work in progress at the time.
Lisa, what do you make of the kind of the last few years of the political correctness element of it, and trying to maybe tweak the song? That Shane
there wrote? Is no political correctness to it.
What do you make of it?
Well, I think it's a lot of nonsense.
Just leave it as it is.
Well, like, I think Shane finishes his songs.
I've been told it's insulting to gays. I don't understand how that works.
Well, I think I suppose it's about whether or not the word faggot should be in a song. That's what people are giving out about.
Oh, fuck that, you know what I mean?
That's the answer to that question. Okay? So, Can we just, that's on the record now, and that debate, in terms of Shane's answer to that question, has been firmly answered tonight. So that's the end of that. We move on
nobody
swiftly.
Nobody in the band thinks that's rather, that's worth seconds though.
Well, know. Then let's move on quickly. Glenn Hansard, the song doesn't get tired, doesn't never feels old, year in, year out. What is it about Fairy Tale of New York that just simply continues to enchant?
I think audiences, listeners, they're smarter than, despite, you know, the Spotify numbers and all the rest, people are intelligent.
Yeah.
And people know when they're being put on, they know when they're being lied to. And a Christmas song that comes from a perspective, well, it's just, it's the truth.
Yeah.
And the song, like, he has wrote an amazing song because it comes at the world from a real perspective, and people just tune into the truth, and they disregard the rest, and a song like that will live on forever.
Julian Temple, you're making a film about Shane already. I can't wait to see it.
Not an easy thing to do.
I don't know why you'd say that, but I'm intrigued.
But worth doing.
Well, right. This whole evening has been worth doing because every time we told people all week...
I can be irritable, you know.
You can be irritable.
Yes.
Well...
There's gold in that irritability.
Well, I imagine, you know, some Irish event in history, you know, well known in Ireland, you know.
Yeah.
And I have to explain it to Julian Temple, you know.
I remember, Shane, when Sid Vicious left the crowd, right? Yeah. There were only two guys with cameras, me and Don Letts. And the only person you could film when Sid wasn't in the crowd was Shane. As a punk, he was one of the like the tribe of the first 100 punks in London. I think he's still got that in him.
Yeah, for sure.
And he lit up the fucking audience just with his fucking appetite for what was going on. You couldn't keep a camera off him. If you had a camera, it was just like magnetic pole on Shane.
Me and Sid were good friends, you know.
This does not shock me for one moment.
I think we did the first interview with Shane ever on film with the Bondage magazine behind you. Do you remember that?
Yeah, back in the...
Back in 76.
76.
Yeah, yeah.
You're born on Christmas Day. I mean, the beauty of that is tremendous. But we do want to celebrate your birthday a little in advance by asking Camilla Sullivan to produce a cockamillish, a little cake. We wish you a happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Shane. Happy birthday to you. Come down from the mountain, Katie Lou.
Okay. Say happy birthday from all of us. I'm going to leave everyone to it. I'm going to go over here and say goodbye to everyone. Well, that's almost it for tonight. And as Shane and Philomena get ready to sing Fairy Tale of New York for us, let me thank everyone involved in tonight's programme for travelling here from all around the world. We'll be back on RT Radio 1, of course, on Monday morning. But tune in next Friday for the last Late Late Show before Christmas. In the meantime, thanks to you and the audience for being here tonight. For Shane, Victoria Mary Clark and all the gang behind the scenes and in front of the camera, you've just been wonderful. I'll leave you now with Shane McGowan, Philomena Begley and friends singing Fairy Tale of New York.
Christmas Eve, babe, in the drunk tank, and an old man said to me, won't see another one. And then he sang a song in a rare old mountain dew. I turned my face away and dreamed about you. Got on a lucky one, came in 18 to 1. I've got a feeling this year's for me and you. So happy Christmas, I love you, baby. I can see a better time when all our dreams come true.
From me,
when I first met you.
I kept him with me, babe. I put him with my arms. Can't make it all alone. I built my dreams around you. The boys in the old green forest are singing Galway Bay, and the bells are ringing out for Christmas Day.